if we want to travel further, if we want to ever go back to the moon, we need to understand how to best help astronauts be able to live in the microgravity or in space. The Artemis initiative is a project that everyone here at NASA is working on. Getting astronauts or getting humans back to the moon is a big task and is requiring a lot from all different communities. The best part of my job is that I have the opportunity to serve this community where I feel like I can weigh in the most in strength and conditioning. We use that exercise device to keep crew members healthy. My name is Corey Twine, and I am an astronaut strength and conditioning specialist here at Johnson Space Center. My job here at NASA is to train the astronauts physically so they are ready for spaceflight. If you think about spaceflight, it's pretty stressful, the stress on the body. Because of that, astronauts have to be in really top shape or physically fit in order to go to space safely. So astronauts up in space are scheduled to work 2.5 hours a day, 6 days a week. Right now, we have a suite on International Space Station of 3 exercise machines. We have the Tilsivus, which is up there now, which is like a bike, or some call it a unicycle. It's pretty interesting because you don't need a seat in space. The second exercise device that we have up there is the T2, or the treadmill, and that machine weighs in for cardiovascular benefit. They have a harness, almost just like a vest, and then there are bungees strapped down to the treadmill, pulling them into the treadmill. The last one that we have is the ARED, or Advanced Resistive Exercise Device, which is the acronym, and we basically just lift weights with that machine. So the fun part of really just barbell weightlifting. One of the things that I do, or we do in my group, is responsible for is we train the crew members on the ARED. And it's important for us to make sure that they have the knowledge of exercise technique and also the function of the machine so they can do that safely while they're in space. One of the things I think people would be surprised by is that astronauts on the International Space Station can call us here at home. I had a call one day from one of the astronauts on the International Space Station that called my cell phone. It scared me initially because it said U.S. government. So when I answered the phone, it was the astronaut. It was like, oh, hey, hi. And we ended up talking, and they had a question about their training, but it was a great asset also because we were able to adjust and then do some things to help their training instead of going through email. I think one of the best ways to motivate people when they're training is to really keep records and to show them improvement. And then when people see that improvement, then it moves to intrinsic motivation where it's not us dependent to motivate them. And they see the benefit of what they're doing. And that is good because we can actually quantify or characterize crew members' cardiorespiratory fitness pre-flight. In addition, get information to determine the best training regimen that they should use in flight. When they come back from a mission, they do continue to train. So in our post-flight reconditioning time frame, we have 45 days set up for crew members to train within for that reconditioning or readaptation phase. We want to make sure that they had the same movement strategies pre-flight that they're going to have post-flight, just from a safety and re-engaging any type of workflow. The reason why we need to study the human body and spaceflight's effects or microgravity effects on the body is because we are able to learn from that, and it can help us in this environment while we're home. It can also help us with exploration. We need to understand how to best help astronauts be able to live in the microgravity or in space. And exercise or exercise countermeasures is a means that we can counteract the negative effects of gravity on the body. If someone would have told me when I was growing up I would be doing this at NASA, I would have said, huh? When I was a kid, I never pictured myself working at NASA. I pictured myself working in the NFL or professional baseball or all of those other dreams that many have. But I am thankful for the position that I currently have, and I'm excited that exercise science has given me this new vision. The path that led me to NASA is a pretty interesting one. Just like many people, all the way back in high school, I was an athlete. I wanted to play at the collegiate level, however, that didn't work out. And so while I was in that undergrad program, I actually had a mentor or one of my professors who was the first strength and conditioning specialist I ever knew or met. Then I learned that, okay, they have people that just train other people in order to prove their performance. From that moment on, I knew exactly what I wanted to do. So in school, I studied kinesiology, an emphasis on exercise science. And basically what exercise science is just a study of how exercise affects the human body. So we're able to, in a scientific means, determine what's the best exercise to prepare people for different activities. Prior to NASA, I had the opportunity to serve two major universities in strength and conditioning, working primarily with football, so collegiate football, and also volleyball. And within both of those, I had an amazing opportunity to interact with student athletes, encourage, mentor, and also help facilitate their physical readiness for their sport. So once I left the university, I ended up going into working with the Army, still in the vein of human performance. And it was an amazing opportunity to work with the soldiers who are doing so much to protect and serve. For students that feel like that they are not smart enough for STEM or cut out for that field, I would say that that would be wrong. I say you have the opportunity and ability to study, find resources, find people in the community, find someone to help you study more, and then continue to do it and continue and just don't give up. I did struggle in middle school and also high school. I really didn't apply myself. I really didn't probably start studying until college. And even in going into college, initially I was a little intimidated. But I had a friend who ended up going to college a few years ahead of me. And I asked him for advice. And the advice he gave me was that there's no test hard if you study for it. And then it was like a light bulb went off. I said, let me try that. So I remember to this day, the first test of my freshman year in college, I studied for the test for the first time. And I read every single thing in the chapter. I read everything in the back of the book. I read all of the information the professor gave, and it worked every single time. So if someone were struggling in middle school or high school, as I also did, I would tell them the same advice that my friend gave me, that no test is hard if you study for it. If we put forth the effort and the time, and some people may need more time than others, that's fine. But if we put forth the effort and the time, we can come out on the other side successful.